Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much for joining us. My name is Angelica Sanders, and I'm here with State Representative Morgan Cephas for the State of the 192nd Virtual Town Hall. So if that's what you're looking for, then you're in the right place. Representative Cephas is here tonight to talk with district members about things that are happening in the district, things that she is working on, and to hear directly from the community. So without further ado, I'm going to go ahead and kick it over to Representative Cephas. Rep Cephas.
Thank you, Angelica. And a special thank you to everybody tonight for joining me for the State of the 192nd Virtual Town Hall discussion. First and foremost, I just want to apologize that we cannot be in person. I do believe since I've taken office, each year we like to do a conversation that specifically focuses on the district. What's happening in the district? What are some of the challenges that we are trying to tackle in the office while I occupy this seat? But then also talk about what we have upcoming for this upcoming year. But then also to hear directly from constituents about what are you interested in seeing us doing? What are some of the topics you are interested in seeing us cover, seeing us address? But then also, helping us put together a plan for the 192nd. So normally we will be able to do that face to face, and I would have loved to be able to be present. But unfortunately, when you add a pandemic to the situation, it definitely creates its own challenges. But one of the things that we've been trying to figure out and trying to be intentional about is keeping residents informed as to what we are doing, again, for the 192nd during this difficult time. But we're also trying to find unique ways to continue to communicate with you. So if you haven't gotten the weekly email blast that we're sending out with a ton of information from unemployment compensation to grants that are available to keeping you updated on the data of COVID-19 cases as well as deaths here in the city of Philadelphia and in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, please add yourself to that email listserv. But some of the other unique ways are through robocalls. We try to send out a robocall at least once a month to, again, keep you informed, talk about some of the activities that we have going on in the district, but also to, mainly be a resource. Last but not least, welcome back to Zoom. We are trying to use Zoom, similar to every business across the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, as an opportunity to provide another touch point. So we will be hosting tonight's discussion on this platform. But then also I really recognize the digital divide that exists, not just in my community and in the 192nd, but across the city of Philadelphia and across the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. When you have a poverty rate that we have here in Philadelphia hovering around 24%, when you have, the unemployment rate that we have, when you have the constant conversation about kids' inability to access the internet, we recognize that we have to add additional platforms so we can communicate with residents as much as possible. So this won't be the only time that you hear from me. So this is the first one of two. Today, again, we will be on this platform having this conversation. But then the following Tuesday, we will be having a teletown hall that will allow you to have a similar conversation. It won't be as extensive as tonight's discussion, but you will be able to call from your phones, hear some of the great information that we have going on for the district, but then also, have a one-on-one conversation with me as well. So those are just some of the events that we are having in the month of February. So with that, we are going to go ahead and get started.
All right, Rep. Cephas. So I'm going to go ahead and just play your slides here, and we can get the conversation started. Just to let everyone know, obviously, we just had a welcome from Representative Cephas. Tonight, we're going to talk about some state updates and district overview, hear from the representative, and then we're going to open the conversation up to hear directly from the participants. So we will be doing a poll, and we'll have two poll questions tonight. If you are signed in via Zoom, you will be able to participate. If you are over the phone, then you won't have the capability to participate, but we do welcome, your feedback in the chat. and we'll go from there. We definitely want to hear from the community and allow the community to help guide our conversation tonight. That was really important to representing Cephas, and that's what we're here to do. And then of course, we'll close it out, but we will allow time for questions, but we're really hoping that the open conversation allows us to address any of the questions and concerns that constituents and attendees may have tonight. Rep. Cephas, if you wanna get started with the staff update.
Absolutely. So, I think you gotta put yourself on mute, Ange. Okay, perfect. So again, I'm going to do my best not to be the only one that is talking tonight. As elected officials, you know, we have a lot of information to say and talk about, but I really want to focus this conversation on what you want to hear about, what you want to talk about. So I will be running through a series of about 10 slides. I'll talk about some staff updates. I'll talk about what's happening up in Harrisburg. We are in budget season. I do sit on the Appropriations Committee. So I'll talk to you a little bit about what our governor has recently proposed. I'll also talk to you about what have been some of the activities that we have been doing during the course of the actual pandemic. But then I'll also talk to you about what are going to be some of our priorities moving forward as a result of the direct conversations that our constituents are having and, you know, about their concerns. And then from there, we'll go into Angelica's two polls that she has prepared for us, using it as an opportunity to interact with the crowd on Zoom. They have so many cool features. I'm still learning like every day. But and from there, we'll have a conversation about what are some of the top priority issues you want me to discuss tonight. And then we'll just open it up to the crowd. So first and foremost, we do have a staff update. As so many of you know, Dawn Cohen, who was my amazing chief of staff for my office for 4 years since I, you know, first got into office, has recently transitioned to help out our neighbor in the 190th Legislative District, who is State Representative Amon Brown. She did have an opportunity to transition in December. So she is no longer with us, but we, you know, wish her well. She's done an amazing job to not just help this office get up off the ground, but really help to, you know, build our staff up to get to where they are currently and to really be a resource for our district, for our business community, and for our constituents. So, you know, we wish her well. If you get a chance to see her, she's still, you know, roaming around in West Philadelphia. Send her our love. But yes, she has transitioned out of the office. And I would like to introduce you to our newest chief of staff, who was Angelica Sanders. You heard her voice. She kicked off tonight's Zoom. She was my former policy director, and you know, one of the penalties of doing great work is to get more work. So please, please wish Angelica much success, and you know, pull up your bootstraps because you know the 192nd, it's a lot of work to do. I also want to introduce you to Jeff. He is our director of constituent services. He is the primary point of contact in our office when it comes to constituent service related issues. He also organizes our outreach events for our community residents. So please welcome Jeff to the team. We will be hiring a director of equitable development, which is, you know, some of the work that Dawn did around matching up grant opportunities on the state level with local organizations, local businesses, local institutions, to ensure that we are getting the equitable funding that we deserve here in our community in the 192nd. Additionally, they will be responsible for organizing different stakeholder conversations. So some of our daycare centers, we're gonna be wanting to hear from them to, you know, just hear how COVID-19 has impacted them. This person will also be interacting with our business community, as well as some of our larger institutions. So, you know, and again, with the focus of equity, because when we don't get our fair share as a district, you know, we're not able to be as prosperous as we can for the city of Philadelphia. Please welcome back Jalil, who is my external affairs coordinator. He primarily is our scheduler for the office. And you know, one of my dear friends, Ms. Gwen Fort, who is also, you know, been with our office since, you know, we got it up and running, who is a constituent service representative. So please welcome all of my staff. Again, hopefully you have, you know, good interactions with them, but these are, this is the team for this 2021-2022 legislative session. All right, so let's go ahead and just jump right in. As I stated, we are going through budget season at this time. So over the next course of 3 weeks, as an Appropriations Committee member, I will be up in Harrisburg having conversations with the governor's staff about the budget proposal that they presented. And one of the things that you are finding nationally as we talk about how COVID-19 has impacted Black and Brown communities, of which is, you know, some of our communities, we, you know, have known for a long time that there is not equity when it comes to how governments are spending their dollars, how they're focusing their resources, and how they're structuring policy. But given, again, you know, how so many communities have been decimated by this pandemic, you've had governments, governors, including our governor, propose a budget that is done through an equitable lens. So when I talk about equity, the question is, you know, when we talk about tax policy, when you talk about raising taxes, how does that disproportionately impact Black and Brown people? So if you, you know, introduce a tax that's a flat tax, that's essentially a regressive tax. Like a low-income person should not be getting taxed as much as somebody that makes over six figures. So that's one of his proposals that he has put forth, is doing a tax cut for working families and ensuring that people are paying their fair share. So that has been a priority. He is extending what is called a special tax credit that will help support, again, working families that are making under a certain threshold. And based on his tax cut proposal, roughly around 67% of working families will either receive no, will require not to pay no income tax, or will be required to pay the same income tax. So 67%. If you can go back to the last slide. Great. He also is talking about making historic investments in education. Currently, right now, we're constantly reminded here in the 192nd that Laura Marion sits just right across the street, and that they're literally spending close to $25,000 per child to educate them, whereas in Philadelphia, we're barely spending $11,000 to $12,000. And, you know, some of those challenges comes from our fair funding formula, which I'm sure you've heard, you know, a lot about. And as we sit today, Pennsylvania ranks around 45th, 46th, as it relates to equitable education funding. And whatever the state is not providing to the municipality, that then requires the municipality to increase your taxes. So one of the approaches that the governor is taking, again, with that equitable lens, is that he's proposing that all of the education dollars go through the fair funding formula. So asking to do that, but in addition, asking for $200 million additional to go into education, which will bring a significant amount of money back to not just 192nd, but across the city of Philadelphia. One of the issues that we constantly talk about is that we're battling with some districts that are seeing a decrease in population, but they're not seeing a decrease in funding. And places like Philadelphia are bearing the brunt of that policy. The next piece, I'm sure you've all have heard, raise the wage. We are the only state in this immediate region that is still stuck at the federal minimum wage. And one of his proposals, again, is to raise the wage. His proposal this time around is to raise it at $12 an hour and over a course of 4 years to get to $15 an hour. Hopefully we get the federal level to just go ahead and adopt Biden's $15 an hour pledge. So we won't even have to worry about here in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. but this is a similar proposal that he's made previously. And unfortunately, you know, when you have a Republican General Assembly, it's extremely difficult to, you know, get this done. But you have our entire country talking about raising the wage. So hopefully we'll be able to get this done this year. Some of the other buckets that he's focusing on, of course, is workforce development funding, ensuring that we have the dollars that we need to retool as many people as possible, but also to allow opportunities to skill up if need be. And, you know, one of the things that, again, we are preparing for with the federal government is that we might see a humongous infrastructure bill. So we want to use opportunities like that, as well as our investments in workforce development, to ensure we are matching job opportunities with what could potentially be coming down the pike. So he's making significant investments in workforce development. Criminal justice reform. One of the areas that he wants to expand is on the Clean Slate Bill, as well as licensing for those that are recently coming out of incarceration. He additionally also wants to put more dollars in social and emotional supports for those that are exiting our prison population. So he's continuing his efforts around criminal justice reform. Last but not least, which is a big bucket, is increased support for childcare services. One of the statistics that we have found is that close to 2.2 million families across our country have left the workforce due to their obligations with childcare and not having access to those opportunities, naturally because of what COVID-19 has done. Not only has it put people not at ease with sending their children back into daycare centers, but it's also forced so many of our daycare centers to close. And you know, one of the things that's going to be critical as we climb out of COVID-19 is that when Biden says we have to build back better, we have to ensure that we're shoring up the infrastructure of our school system, of our childcare system, so we can get our working families back to work. So those are some of his top priorities this budget season. One of the great things that we are going to institute, I've joined a team of my fellow legislators where we want to bring the appropriations conversation to the community. Similar to what city council does, which allows for public comment towards the end of their budget season, that's not something that the state government does. And that's something that we will be pushing for. So look out for that, for us to have another conversation about what constituents are interested in seeing in their government here in Pennsylvania. You can go to the next one. Okay, just some legislative updates. I do have some new committee assignments. I'm returning to appropriations, which is a really big committee. Again, when you think about the priorities of a society, you look at where they're putting their money. And that's one of the reasons why I've asked to return to appropriations, and just so I can ensure that our voice is heard at that table when they're talking about the budget. Additionally, I sit on the insurance committee. I specially requested insurance and health, naturally because of what we're dealing with. Again, COVID-19 has, you know, decimated so many communities, but this isn't a new conversation that we're having. It's not a new conversation for us to know here in the 192nd that the closest hospital system to us is outside of our county at Lincoln All Hospital. And the only way that you can't really travel there, it's not easily accessible. And, you know, it causes for, you know, health disparities in our district that we could fix if we had more of an equitable healthcare system. I will be returning to labor and industry. One of the top issues that we've been facing over the course of this pandemic is access to unemployment. That has been what the top issue people have been calling my office for. And, you know, I just want to, you know, put a quick plug in for my staff. They've literally had to turn into unemployment compensation specialists, which is, you know, not technically their job. Their job is just to connect you to the department. But because of the department experiencing roughly 40,000 unemployment compensation requests as of before we started COVID-19, all the way to 2 million requests. So they are extremely inundated up in that department. And, you know, that on a weekly basis, they're training our staff to help us better communicate with our constituents around unemployment compensation. But I'm sure somebody's going to have a question about that tonight. So I'll save it for them. I also sit on committees, which can sound confusing, but one of the roles is to look at just reviewing the committee structure that we currently have. And, you know, if there is a need to expand, to just help be a part of that conversation to ensure that we're covering every issue that is a challenge in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, and forming committees based on if we need to add or if we need to subtract. So that's the role of that. I've been returned to the Pennsylvania Workforce Development Board, and I am newly appointed to the Pennsylvania Commission for Women. Some of the policy agenda priorities, again, for this year that I will be focusing on is health equity. Of course, that has been, you know, a passion of mine since I've come into the legislature, specifically around access to quality healthcare, and especially as it relates to maternal health and maternal mortality. The second hot button issue we will be focusing on is, of course, education and childcare access. We are in an extremely dire situation as it relates to our education system, not just with the digital divide, but with our students needing to go back into the classroom, which is a conversation I'm sure we're going to get in, you know, later during this discussion, but also increasing access to childcare as much as possible. The other issue that, you know, we cannot negate is the issue of gun violence here in the city of Philadelphia, with having 61 murders that have taken place already, with seven just in the previous day. We are in a crisis, and it has to be all hands on deck in order for us to really move the needle into the right direction, because we are absolutely going into the wrong direction. And I tie in the idea of opportunity youth with gun violence, because opportunity youth is essentially the population that's 16 to 24 years old that's not connected to any job opportunity or any education opportunity. And this is the population that is involved in a lot of our gun violence. So in the 192nd, we will be focusing primarily on that group to help solve some of the violence challenges that we have here in the district. The other two buckets that, you know, we're really going to hone in on is housing support and small business support. One of the things that I was adamant about during COVID-19 is that when we spend close to $4 billion of COVID-19 money here in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, we have to do it in an equitable way. When you have places like the city of Philadelphia that has been hit the hardest county hit in the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, the county that has been closed the longest, we really have to ensure that we're targeting our dollars to where it's hardest hit, and that is here in the city of Philadelphia, especially as it relates to housing and small businesses. So these will be my priorities over the next quarter as we go into budget season. Now, this slide is just to remind you of the constituent services that we do provide here in the office. Oftentimes, the majority, I would say about 70% of our calls that come into the office are actually city related. But one of the things I ran on is that we would be a one-stop shop. And, you know, given the experience that I've had in city council, I do make it a priority for my staff to at least be able to handle as much as possible city related issues. But primarily, what we are responsible for is PennDOT services. So you can come and get that senior key card. Unemployment compensation, of course, you know, again, is the top issue that we've been dealing with as we speak. Birth certificate applications, PA income tax problems. I mean, you can read, you know, all of the issues that we deal with. And it's also, this information is also included in the newsletters that we send out as well. All right, I'm going to move through these slides relatively quickly just so we can get to questions and answers. So here's just some of the things that we've been doing through during COVID-19, especially in a socially distanced way. So I don't want you to think that we've, you know, been endangering people, but we've done PPE giveaways. We've partnered with various elected officials to not just do the PPE giveaways, but also to establish food banks in the district. We also were able to do a senior turkey giveaway that was co-sponsored with the Independence Blue Cross. We also did a big job on census outreach, which was really critical because our numbers were extremely bad at the beginning of the census. One of the other things I recognized in the district immediately that I myself, when I had to get tested for COVID-19, I had to go outside of the city of Philadelphia and at least wait for about 2 hours, which again, when we talk about health equity, is just not a reality that we can afford to live in. So we worked closely with Walgreens to get a free testing site established at the Walgreens that's on 63rd Street. Additionally, voting access was extremely critical this past election cycle. And so we worked collectively with, again, our city council person, our state senator, Vincent Hughes and Curtis Jones Jr. to ensure that we were able to secure a voting access center here in the district. Again, two top issues that we've been working on in the office have been the unemployment compensation and property tax rent rebates. So all of these events, again, we had to work strategically with our local and state elected officials so we can, you know, when all hands need to be on deck, we want to make sure that we're able to provide as many resources as possible. And we weren't able to do that without Councilman Curtis Jones Jr., Councilwoman Catherine Gilmer Richardson, State Senator Vincent Hughes, as well as Congressman Evans. We all were in this together and all were able to service the community relatively well during this pandemic, but we do have a lot more to go. All right, just really quickly, one of the things I firmly believe, if it's not measured, it's not managed. Every single year, I want to be able to tell the community what we've been doing, what we've been working on, how many constituents we've served, how much money we've brought in back to the district. And, you know, we've been able to do a really good job with keeping grant opportunities coming back into the area. Some of the things that I've wanted to highlight is we were able to bring back $1 million to the Overbrook Pharmacy Wellness Center. We additionally were able to partner with the Overbrook School for the Blind to bring some dollars back to them. Additionally, we've been working with Overbrook West Neighbors to bring a pilot housing repair project into the area. We also are working with an organization called TFAB that also is doing minor housing repair in the Carroll Park and Haddington area. So one of the things we really like to do is look for organizations that, you know, want to work with our office to, one, identify grant opportunities to ensure that they're investing in the 192nd Legislative District. So these were some of the things that we've been able to accomplish this year. Our goal is always to at least bring back $1 to $2 million into the district, just so, again, we get our fair share from the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania. So if you've seen our newsletter, we've just recently sent one out. We have a lot of this detail is included in that newsletter. All right. Again, I just wanted to touch base on some of our top constituent service priorities that we'll be focusing on in this first quarter. One, of course, again, is the unemployment compensation. Not that we've only struggled, I feel like the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania has struggled as it relates to ensuring a seamless transition with unemployment compensation. And unfortunately, there have just been so many bumps and just so many bruises. So one of the things that we are going to do in our office, of course, we're going to do unemployment compensation, you know, throughout every day. But we're going to be focusing like one day out of the week specifically all we do is unemployment compensation cases. So look out for that announcement. We will be finding that day and that time frame that we will be offering that service to, again, ensure that we are we're providing direct service around this issue. Now, the property tax and rent rebate, we are still, can you go back to the last slide? We are still, we're still managing those cases as they come in. When it comes to district testing and vaccine distribution, one of the things that you would have recognized already is the coordination of our testing and our vaccine distribution here in the city of Philadelphia is an interesting experience, I'll just say. So one of the things that we are going to do here for the 192nd Legislative District, we're going to do a couple of things. So one, we are looking to partner with organizations that are getting direct allotments of the vaccine. And we're going to be looking to host direct events here in the district as it relates to the distribution. And examples of that is Lincoln All Hospital supports this community and they get direct allotments of the vaccine. So we're in talks with them to coordinate some type of event for the 192nd to have a direct event here to distribute the vaccine. We also are in conversations with Rite Aid to do the same thing, who is getting direct allotments for the vaccine as well. So we'll be doing that. The second thing is that we will be establishing a hotline in our office for those that are 65 and older to call into our office so we can get you help registered in the city system. One of the challenges that we've recognized is that a lot of seniors don't have access to a computer system, or it's just difficult to navigate. So we will be offering that service shortly, again, to connect our most vulnerable population to these opportunities. The third piece is that we will constantly have PPE readily available in our office in the case that any individual is in need of that resource. Last but not least, so those are the three things that we're going to be doing to try to, again, coordinate our own individual vaccine distribution plan, as well as testing. Again, we're going to keep working with Walgreens to ensure that they maintain that testing site, because again, it is the only one that we have in the district. Last but not least is the education reopening plan. If many of you saw me on social media, standing up at a podium at Gompers Elementary School, demanding that our school district of Philadelphia to come up with a better plan that keeps both our families and our teachers safe. So we are working closely with the school district, as well as so many of my other colleagues, to establish a better plan, because the plan that we have right now is not sufficient. And it, again, still leaves families concerned, which is not, which is something that we cannot do in our current climate. But with the city's recent announcement of their partnership with CHOP, one of the things that, again, we're gonna try to do is with their talks about having pop-up clinics, we are going to try to secure a pop-up clinic here in the 192nd Legislative District. So those are some of the top constituent service priorities that we are dealing with in this first quarter. But now I'm going to turn it over to Angelica to just talk about where we go from here. We're going to do a quick survey, two surveys, and then we are going to open it up to have a conversation with those that are joining us tonight.
Thank you, Rep. Cephas. Definitely thank you for providing the updates to the district. We certainly hope that that was helpful to the attendees here tonight. Of course, we want to engage in some meaningful conversation about priorities for the district. And so I'm gonna go ahead and move on to our first question of the night. I wanna talk about the 192nd district. And we wanna know from our callers here today and our participants here today, what the top three issues are that you wanna discuss with the representative tonight. As we prepare tonight's agenda and with just so much going on, we really got to a point where it was like, let's hear from the constituents what they want to talk about most, and then use that to direct our conversation. And so if you are joining from a computer, you should see a polling question to have come up on your screen. What are the top three issues you want to discuss with the representative tonight? The first answer is COVID-19. The first option is COVID-19 response and vaccine. Second option is unemployment, employment opportunities, and job training. Third option is gun violence response. Fourth is education. Next is housing security. And last but not least is voting and voter rights, considering the historic election that we just came off. So if you could just pick your top three tonight, we know that all of these issues are important to you. They are important to us. They are important to the representative, but we wanna, you know, engage in some specific conversation tonight. So if you could just pick your top three, we'll give it about two more minutes. And then the top three answers are the ones that we're gonna run with and talk a little bit more about tonight. Of course, if we don't end up talking about a topic that you prioritize or that you had at the top of your list, our office is always here. When we close out, we will make sure we put our contact information on there. We can reach out and definitely continue the conversation. Right now, it looks like gun violence response is leading with 72%. But like I said, we're going to give it two more minutes. So that's about one more minute now, and then we'll end the polling. All right, so number one, at 74%, we have gun violence response, representative. The number two answer for the top priorities that we wanna discuss tonight at 56% is unemployment, employment opportunities, and job training, just as we expected with that unemployment, right? And then the third runner-up with 50% is COVID-19 response and vaccine. So it doesn't mean that if you have any questions or concerns related to education, housing, security, and voting and voter rights, that you can't ask them. Definitely put some specific questions in the chat, but we wanna go ahead and get started and talk about a little bit more about gun violence response. Rep. Cephas, if you wanna kick it off with that. If there are any questions, feel free to put them in the chat and either our staff or the representative will get back to you.
Great, thank you. Really cool feature on this tool to really be able to get some real live time interaction. So gun violence, as you naturally see, has become an epidemic across the city of Philadelphia. It has become a challenge across the entire country. For some reason, even though under all of these restrictions, we're still experiencing an uptick and naturally on pace to exceed the gun violence that we experienced last year, which is extremely unfortunate. Some of the things that I have been working on from a Harrisburg perspective, of course, one is to strengthen our gun laws in Harrisburg. I can talk to you about the challenges with Republicans all day, but one of the things that we are collectively realizing that this is a national, epidemic that is happening. And if we don't do something now, then we could potentially lose generations upon generations. So in working with some of my colleagues up in Harrisburg, some of the things that we are going to be focusing on is about three things. One is strengthening and tightening our laws around background checks and ensuring that we are able to, you know, have that tightened as much as possible. So we're, you know, screening those individuals who are able to get guns and those who probably should not. That's number one. Number two is strengthening our gun loophole that exists at gun shows. If you haven't experienced going to an actual gun show, it is an experience. It is literally almost a football field of rifles, of ammunition. And it can be a little bit troubling because as I visited one a couple of years back, as soon as an individual was going in to purchase a gun, they literally were able to go out and sell it to someone else. And, you know, extremely unfortunate. So an additional issue that we're going to try to address with gun violence is having our governor invest more in gun violence prevention programs. So some of the things that I've been able to do is help secure some of the organizations here in the 192nd that work on gun violence reduction. We've been able to get them grants from the state level, but then also get grants, help support applications for the city's grant program. So we've been able to do that. One of the grants that I was recently able to get was to help support the city's efforts around the gun violence reduction initiative. And the sole purpose of that initiative is to target those who are actually doing the criminal activities. But the approach is to provide them opportunities to choose a different and separate path first, but then also remind them that there are consequences and penalties if you continue down, you know, that path. So working alongside my colleague at the time, State Representative Ronnie Green and State Representative Joanna McClinton, we were able to get $500,000 to help support that city-related program. Additionally, we're working alongside our district attorney, who has placed assistant district attorneys into our local police districts to help better coordinate the processing of individuals that are committing these crimes. I see somebody in the feed talking about straw purchases. I used to be the chair of the Women and Girls of Color subcommittee, and the new chair is now focusing on strengthening laws around straw purchasers as well. So I did just see that in the chat. So those are some of the things that I've been personally working on. Looking to find Republicans that are willing to strengthen our gun laws up in Harrisburg, because if we don't get the guns off the street, if we don't work with our attorney general to help process gun trafficking here in the city of Philadelphia, it's something that we're not going to be able to accomplish. Additionally, bringing back those resources to help support those organizations that are on the ground doing the work is also going to be critical. The governor, this budget cycle has invested additional dollars into what is called PCCD. This is the commission on the state level that funnels out grants directly to organizations based on gun violence. So investing additionally in that, but then working alongside our local 19 police district, as well as our district attorney, to see how we can work collaboratively to tackle the issue of gun violence. You know, one of the recommendations coming from the 19 police district was to help coordinate crime mapping and to see where the hotspots are and ensure that we have policing readily available at those hotspots. I mean, hotspots don't exist all over the 192nd. We just need to ensure that we have the coverage where we need them. Additionally, is adding additional lighting to different areas throughout the district so we don't create opportunities for crime because it's dark or because it's blighted. So ensure that, you know, we add that component to it as well. But I mean, as you know, gun violence in the city of Philadelphia has been a very difficult issue for this entire city. And just one of the things I just see as doing my part is to bring the resources back as much as possible to help support our mayor and our local city council members to implement programming on the city level, but also trying to find that Republican that's going to help us move the needle on the series of legislative proposals that I just talked about earlier. So it's a multi-layered pronged strategy. I think the last piece around gun violence is that if we're asking them to put down these guns, we have to be able to transition them into another workforce opportunity. So one of the things that I've recently been able to do is secure a grant from the state to work with Philadelphia Works, which is the organization that that does job training for the city of Philadelphia, that partners individuals up with job opportunities. So working with Philadelphia Works and working with PICO to create a job training program and a pipeline program into PICO, one where they're able to earn and learn at the same time, but then be able to land a job at the end of the opportunity. So that is something that will be announced within the next several weeks, because again, we can't ask them to put down a gun or get out of a certain type of life if we're not giving them a skill set or not giving them a job that provides them the opportunity to live that quality of life that they want. So again, three-pronged strategy: legislation, resources investing into neighborhood organizations, and again, creating that workforce development pipeline for those that want to get out of this type of life. I couldn't remember what the second one was.
Oh, no problem. Thanks, Rep. Susan, for going a little bit more into detail about what you and the state is doing to address gun violence, which is kind of unique to the city of Philadelphia when you compare it to Pennsylvania overall, but you know, something that needs to be addressed regardless. And so we definitely appreciate that. So the next thing on the next topic that was the next topic was unemployment, employment opportunities, and job training.
Yes, of course. Again, similar to what I said about addressing the crime, the gun violence issue in the district. I'm looking to create a job training program or strategy based on a series of populations. So one population I talked to you about earlier is that opportunity youth population, which is that 16 to 24 individual that is disconnected to either work or an education opportunity. And that is what the grant with Philadelphia Works and PICO and a series of other companies that are in the 192nd and to create a pipeline. That's what we'll be doing around job training. We'll be putting that together, but also hosting a series of job fairs and things like that targeted to that population to, you know, move them along into the right direction. Additionally, we do this event every single year with the Philadelphia Youth Network and a couple of other youth-related organizations where we have a panel discussion, but then we also do somewhat of a job preparation and training boot camp. And then we have a workshop series essentially where we're signing kids that are 18 and under up for the Work Ready program that exists here for the city of Philadelphia. We've been doing that since I got into office. As you all know, I worked for some time at the Philadelphia Youth Network. And one of the things I immediately realized coming into that job opportunity is that there was a big digital divide. A lot of our kids in the 192nd were not able to connect to the internet, meaning they could not connect to the Philadelphia Youth Network. So that is a partnership that we will continue this year. Yes, of course, they're not doing on-site job opportunities, but everything's moving to virtual. But the great thing is that they're still keeping up with paying our students. So we still want to keep them active. We still want to, you know, give them an opportunity to earn and learn at the same time. So we will be targeting our, again, 18 and under, primarily high school and middle school students to partner them up that way. Now, as it relates to unemployment, again, this has been a significant challenge for us. It has been, you know, the top issue coming into our office, and we are still working with labor and industry to correct some of the challenges that we've experienced with this system. I've had a conversation with my labor and industry chair this morning where we talked about creating a bill alongside Republicans to just right-size this system that hasn't been updated for some time. So that's one thing that we will be doing. I'll also be offering legislation that, so right now, if you have received overpayments for unemployment at one point in your life, and then you go try to apply for unemployment again, they literally just take your entire check until that overpayment is paid back. But we're trying to get them to a point where they're providing you possibly 25 to 50% of what you are owed in unemployment and allow the rest to be paid, be put towards what you actually owe the state. So those are some, that's, you know, a legislative piece that we will be offering in the near future. Additionally, as I stated earlier, we are gonna dedicate one day out of the week where we are solely focusing on unemployment compensation cases to ensure that we are just providing that direct service. And we're gonna be doing that until until this pandemic is over. because just trying to get our residents connected to this system has just been a big challenge. And again, I just want to thank you for just all being patient with my office, with getting back to you on these issues. And I just want to thank my staff for providing dual duties with the Office of Labor and Industry to help provide that service.
Yes, unemployment has definitely been a challenge, for us as a team. We know that the department is suffering some challenges of their own, but it's definitely something we look forward to moving forward and helping the constituents with. Hopefully, some of you on the call have been able to be assisted by our office with that, and we look forward to continuing to do so until they figure it out. So thanks for giving that update and an update on some of the things that you're doing to address employment opportunities in the district. Last but not least, the third topic that rang tonight was COVID-19 response and vaccine. If you can go a little bit more into detail about that, then we will open it up for Q&A. So make sure that you are adding your questions to the Q&A box. And when the representative lets us know about this topic, we'll go ahead and move on to Q&A.
Absolutely. So as you know, our vaccine and COVID response has been similar to other areas across the country, extremely challenging. Here in the city of Philadelphia, we have 108 confirmed cases with close to 3,000 deaths. And what is somewhat challenging is that the federal government is essentially distributing vaccines in multiple ways, where not only is the city of Philadelphia getting a direct allotment, but several of our pharmacies are getting a direct allotment. Some of our hospitals are getting a direct allotment. Some of the area organizations like Oak Street Health is getting direct allotments. So it just seems that the city is having some challenges and some difficulties with just managing who's getting what, but then also who's signing up for which organization to get the vaccine. You have some residents that are signing up for multiple vaccines, well, multiple locations for the vaccine. But then you also have organizations that have people signing up for the vaccination. And because they cannot, once they are unthawed, they don't want to throw them away. So they're just randomly asking people, have you received it? If you want it, come and get it. So, I think all that I would say is just, give the city some time to manage their system. And, just in case if people didn't know this, the way that our healthcare system is structured here in Pennsylvania, Philadelphia essentially runs its own healthcare system. So even as a state rep, my point of contact when it comes to the vaccines is Dr. Farley, who is the city health commissioner, because again, the State Department of Health does not manage Philadelphia. Philadelphia manages itself. So as a direct result of recognizing that the city is trying to manage its own system, I talked about it previously in the PowerPoint presentation that here in 192nd, we're gonna try to do a couple of things. One is we are gonna establish a hotline for those that are 75 and older. And we're gonna base that hotline on whatever phase that we're in. So right now we're in phase B, which allows for those that are 75 and older to get access to the vaccine, frontline workers, those individuals that have health conditions. So we're gonna base our hotline based off of, again, which phase that we're in. So for right now, we are going to allow individuals that don't have computer access but qualify under phase B to contact our office, and we will connect you directly with the city site. So that's number one. Number two, we will even know that it's difficult with just even keeping up with all the information that's coming out. So what we will commit to doing is a robocall on a bi-weekly basis, just informing residents as to where we are here in the city of Philadelphia. We're still in phase 1B. We'll announce that we're in phase 1B, and we'll let you know who phase 1B applies to. We'll also remind you of how to, if you want to register for the vaccine on your own, we'll remind you of the number for you to call. We'll also give out the website for you to use if you want to access it. So we'll do our best with keeping the public in the 192nd updated through robocalls, probably every other week. So we're not, you know, bugging you too much, but it will also be included in every form of communication that we use currently in our office, which also includes our email blast. So again, if you're not a part of that system, please make sure you contact my office to make sure you are. Third and finally, when it comes to the vaccine, and again, I mentioned this earlier in the presentation, is that we're going to work extremely hard to identify a partner to partner with our office to coordinate a vaccine event. Again, we have a couple of partners that have showed interest. One, of course, including Lincoln All Hospital has showed some interest. We have a meeting coming up with them. Some of our area pharmacies, which includes Rite Aid, Walgreens, and CVS, we are going to try to nail one of them down to host a joint a mobile vaccine event with us. We also are going to look to the city of Philadelphia. And, you know, shout out to Charlita Davis, who I know is on the line. So just tell the councilman we are going to be tagging him as well to get the city of Philadelphia in their new partnership with CHOP to use somewhere in 192nd as a pop-up clinic. Again, all politics is local. My focus is on the residents of 192nd and to ensure that you have access to this health opportunity. So that is what we'll be doing over the next couple of weeks, is trying to secure that partnership. Last but not least, I do see the Black doctors. Somebody mentioned them. If anybody can get the Black doctors, you let me know. they are a very hot commodity in the city of Philadelphia. And I mean, they're running the operation down at the Lear Core Center. We will try extremely hard to get them as well, as much as we can. They were able to do some testing up in the 192nd at Penn Memorial, but trying to get them to do a vaccine event just has been a little bit challenging because they're just in so much high demand. But I do beyond excited with their work and, you know, their commitment to Black and Brown communities. So the last thing is that we're going to really try to work alongside we're going to try to work alongside Walgreens to maintain that testing site, because again, it is the only testing site that we have in the district. So that's pretty much what our approach to the vaccine and testing strategy is here for the 192nd. Again, you know, no guarantees. I think our main goal is just to keep you informed as to where we are with things, but then try to, you know, really work to secure a partnership with an outside entity to partner with us on a vaccination event.
We definitely know that everything going on with the pandemic is something that everyone wants to know about. And of course, we would like to have all the answers, and we don't, but this is a resource so that we can know as much as possible and have access to as much as possible. So we definitely appreciate that. So I'm going to open it now for Q&A. People have definitely been using the chat in the Q&A feature on the Zoom tonight. And so I'm going to start with a question from an anonymous attendee who said, what are the root causes of gun violence, for the gun violence? As examples, could the violence be related to unemployment, drugs, mental health, family dynamics, lack of other activities in the community? Rep. Cephas, you want to speak to that?
I mean, I think it's related to so many of those things. I think for a very long time in the city of Philadelphia, you had a lot of lack of investment in, you know, a lot of our institutions and in our neighborhoods. You know, when I was growing up, you saw a lot, and you continue to see a lot of investment happen in Center City. And when you're investing in one section of the city and pushing people out to other parts of the city, you're inevitably going to, you know, create patterns of poverty and patterns of crime, the more and more that you do not invest in communities. And for some time, I believe that that's what Philadelphia was doing. Again, when I was growing up, I had to travel an hour outside of my neighborhood in order to access a quality education. When you have to go all the way down to Broad and Alleyne, to access a magnet school, that's a challenge. When you don't have readily access to education in your immediate neighborhood or in your zip code, that's your city not investing in the future of your education, which I do believe is a tool to move you out of poverty. Additionally, I do think it's the trauma that we've experienced in so many of our communities, the lack of mental health resources that are available, conflict resolution. People talk about it all the time, needing to be brought back in, you know, within our with our young people. I think that is a missed opportunity. Additionally, the struggles that are that exist within our family structure, where you have, you know, parents that are struggling to, you know, maintain job opportunities that pay, you know, quality wages. When you have, you know, lack of healthcare opportunities, when you have environmental justice challenges happening in a neighborhood, when you have all of this being confined onto one community all at one time, you create natural stresses in individuals that live in these environments. And I think, you know, for a long time, that lack of investment has, you know, led to the outcomes that we're experiencing. Additionally, I think when you start to see investments, you start seeing gentrification where you have residents coming in with the intention of pushing individuals out. And, you know, when that happens, that like, for example, here in West Philadelphia, you've had significant gentrification happen in South Philadelphia and in North Philadelphia. And you have territorial challenges that, you know, naturally will come up into an area where individuals from different neighborhoods are pushed into the same environment that potentially creates, you know, turf wars. You just have all of these challenges compounding all at once on communities, I feel like has led to the gun violence that we're experiencing.
Thanks. It definitely is a complex issue. We definitely appreciate the question because, you know, depending on where you're at, you know, might be depending on what you see and what is connected to this issue. It is a complex issue and we appreciate you, you know, working towards that. I have another question. Given the prevalence of technology and the role that it will continue to play with the within the future workforce, will the job training be preparing Philadelphians for remote work?
Great question. I think there are job opportunities or job training programs that are focusing specifically on that, and that are focusing on jobs that are 2021 jobs and, you know, preparing us for for the future. As you know, a lot of jobs are being automated. And with this new, with the new environment that we are in, we have to essentially tool people up to be prepared for that level of technology that will be expected for all new jobs. So I think having a partnership, I mean, the great thing about Philadelphia Works and being on the Workforce Investment Board is that we study trends on what jobs in the economy are dwindling, but also what jobs are gonna be thriving post COVID-19. So when we think about, you know, the hospitality industry, or when we think about industries that have been, you know, impacted by our current circumstances, we have to begin retooling our young people, our young adults, and, you know, those that are interested in skilling up to be prepared for what's coming down the pike. And one of the things I constantly say is that every crisis we should look at as an opportunity. So when we're talking about pumping so much money into our economy as a result of COVID-19, how are we being strategic when we build back our economy and our businesses to match, you know, the job skills and the job abilities that individuals are going to have to meet the need of, you know, what's coming down the pike. So to answer your question is, you know, yes, we need to ensure that we are incorporating digital literacy in any future job training program that we create.
Thank you. So the next question is, will the charter schools in the district receive grant money? What about the elementary schools in the district, such as OEC, Overbrook Elementary, and others? Can you speak to that a little bit?
What was the question again? That you saw that charter schools have received grant dollars and
What about the non-charter schools? I guess they would be probably part of the SDP, such as Overbrook Elementary Center and Overbrook Elementary School.
Yes, so each school individually has the ability to go after grants. And we have in the past have helped Overbrook High School, for example, secure a grant for, a healthy foods grant that we helped them secure. They needed some additional refrigeration components in order to create a healthy foods program at Overbrook High School. Lamberton Elementary School, for example, we're working with them to help build an actual playground on their site. So right now we're working with the Community Design Collaborative, which is a nonprofit pro bono organization that provides free architectural services. That grant will be upwards to around $50,000 to $60,000. And then afterwards, after we put together a formal plan for the actual school, we're gonna go after additional state dollars, at least $250,000, to help actually build the playground structure. Additionally, we helped, the school is called ACES. I don't remember what the acronym stands for. No, that's a charter school. I'll give you the example of Overbrook Education Center that sits at 65th and Lansdowne. We were able to help them secure a Kaboom grant that helped them put their play equipment up. So we find strategic ways to help our public schools to go after grant dollars. So for example, we helped the School District of Philadelphia get dollars to help support their Digital Divide program. So, you know, one of the things that we do in the office is as soon as we get information about grant opportunities coming down from the state, we have a listserv that includes small businesses, that includes nonprofit organizations, that also includes all of our schools in our district to make sure that they have the information that they need about resources that are available. And then we also provide support letters for those grant opportunities. And, you know, we work with the state to ensure that we're helping to secure them those dollars. So we're intentional about helping both public schools and our charter schools. I grew up in a public school system all my life. So it is near and dear to my heart, and it serves a significant number of the students in 192nd.
Thanks for that, Rep. Cephas. So the next question I have is from Linda. Linda asks if you know of any programs for homeowners who need help with financial assistance for home repairs.
I'm glad you mentioned that. I'm sure we have an email address that we will drop in our chat feed. One of the things that we've been recently able to do, and these are two pilot programs, we've been able to partner with some area organizations. One is Overbrook West Neighbors that covers the Overbrook area. The other organization is entitled TFED. And they cover the Carroll Park and Haddington area, where the pilot program is similar to the city's basic systems home repair program. So we were able to get them dollars to create a pilot of something that's similar, where they're just taking care of minor repairs for senior citizens. We were able to, thank you, Angie. We were able to get them dollars to help support creating a pilot that focuses just on that for the 192nd Legislative District. So if one of my staffers can put their email addresses into the chat, and we will connect with you afterwards to see, one, if you're eligible for the programs that they've created, and if not, how can we get you access to another agency in the state that will help support you? But I'm glad you asked that question, because we worked really hard on doing that.
Yeah, so we definitely hope that as pilot programs are something that are able to, continue to grow and serve the district continually. So the next question is from Kathy. Kathy asks, while voter access and rights was not ranked high on the poll, there's still a concern with a number of states with Republican majorities and the laws they are trying to pass to make voting significantly harder for many citizens. Pennsylvania is trying to pass similar unfair laws. Can you speak to what plans you have or any of your colleagues have to fight this in our state and what we can do as citizens to join the fight?
I'm glad you asked that question because, you know, if it wasn't for some of the work that we were able to do in Harrisburg, we could have had the potential to have our votes suppressed, but then also to have, you know, not our new president and our forever vice president in the White House as we speak. So it definitely was a hardcore fight, and the Republican Party was trying to undermine us the entire way. So some of the things that, you know, we were able to implement was, of course, early voting, earlier voter registration, mail-in voting, which was, you know, really key to this election cycle. But I think one of the things that was mainly important was to get those satellite sites to be allowed in the city of Philadelphia. That was critical. And as I'm sure you know, throughout this past year, we were taken to court for almost everything. So it was a hardcore fight, but knowing that our General Assembly is a Republican General Assembly, they're going to be extremely aggressive to ensure that our voting rights continue, or at least they try to continue to suppress our voting access. So that is something that we are all very much paying attention to, because next year is a really big year. Not only am I running for re-election, but our congressional members are running for re-election. We have a governor that is coming up for re-election, and we have Senator Toomey, who has recently resigned. His seat is coming up. So of course, they are going to want to be adamant about finding additional ways to prevent us from having access to the ballot box and also using intimidation. So this is going to be a hot button issue this legislative cycle. And some of the things that we are trying to implement as a result of what we had just experienced. One is pre-canvassing. As you know, it took us, you know, a very long time to count the ballots because we couldn't open them until we got closer to election day, which created a challenge and created a backlog. Additionally, we want to make sure that we're able to have same day voter registration. So, you know, you don't have to wait a period of time or be blocked or even have a deadline when it comes to, you know, being able to register to vote. If you want to wake up and vote that day, you should be able to have the accessibility to do so. And we will be able to do that with same day voter registration. Additionally, they're still taking us to court over our satellite site. So we have to strengthen our laws around that to ensure that we are still able to have access to that opportunity. Those are going to be some of the things that we're going to be fighting for. Again, they are going to do everything they can to suppress our ability to have access to the voting booths. And one of the things that's going to be key is that redistricting is coming up. So I'm sure you've heard the conversation about gerrymandering, where they carve out districts that make them Republican safe districts. And that's one of the reasons why Pennsylvania went red previously, because we always talk about it's Philadelphia and Pittsburgh and Pennsylvania in the middle. The way our lines are drawn gives them a Republican edge. So that is something that is going to be coming up relatively quickly. So we have a very huge battle coming up to where we have to stay diligent. And one of the things I would just recommend constituents do is still make this a top priority, voting and voter rights. Whether that be me hosting an additional panel discussion. I see somebody's talking about judicial redistricting, which is another hot button issue that would literally take us more than 20 minutes to talk about, but maybe we can have a targeted conversation as a district about voting and voting rights and judicial gerrymandering, which is something that the Republicans are also trying to do. I won't go into that now again, because that'll take, you know, a longer conversation. But if that is something that the district is interested in, is having possibly a monthly conversation about different topics, that's something that we can consider. But as I mentioned, voting and voting rights is going to be a critical issue for the next 2 years. Again, we have significant races that are coming up, and they are trying to turn our General Assembly more red. So they have a supermajority. They have a supermajority currently in the Senate. They don't have it in the House. And when you have a supermajority, the governor, it doesn't matter what the governor does. So that's something that they're going to be aiming for. They're also going to want a Republican governor and a Republican senator. So they are going to be out in droves and very focused on this issue. So maybe that's something we can do as a follow-up. Let's have a separate conversation about voting and voting rights, what's coming down the pipe, what you can do as citizens, but then also come up, talk about the next upcoming election cycle. You know, we have our district attorney and we have judges that are up for election, not just city of Philadelphia judges, but also our appellate court judges. And as you know, the cases around the Donald Trump challenges went to our appellate courts, and our appellate courts are heavily Republican. So that's just something that we just also have to pay attention to. And we only got 10 minutes left, so I will, you know, stop it there. But, you know, we can definitely have a follow-up conversation. That would be an interesting topic to discuss.
Thanks, Rep. Cephas. Yes, we have 10 more minutes left, and we want to leave some time for our last polling question. And so this is going to be the last question of the evening for Q&A. Of course, if you're attending and you had a question that we did not get to tonight, all of our staff information will be in the chat and at the end of this presentation. So definitely reach out to us and we can follow up. But the last question for a Q&A is going to be, what will be different about your job training program that will ensure completion and follow through? Job training programs have been around since the turn of the century. So how do we ensure that it's actually going to make an impact in that age bracket when you talk about the opportunity youth 16 to 24 years old? What is the baseline?
That is a great question. That is a great question. I think for me, this defining what success is going to, I believe, make the training program different. And what success means to me is placement, whether that is placement in some education institution that the individual is interested in getting into. But that education institution, either if it's a four-year college or a two-year training program, that individual has to be placed in a setting where they have a pathway to get some type of credential. I think that's one part of it. Another part of the placement is job placement. Do they actually acquire the job that they are setting out to go after? So if they're going through a training program, what type of job opportunity are they getting as a result of that training program? And do they get into that job? I think the third and final piece for me is the idea of credentialing. I don't want to just send people through a workforce development program where they're not able to create or access stackable credentialing that will make them competitive in the job market. So if we're taking them through, so for example, Angelica had an opportunity of sharing with me about the West Philadelphia Skills Initiative, which is run by the University of Pennsylvania. Right now they have a training program that's teaching young people to get their CDL. And as you know, to get your CDL is extremely difficult, but it's also extremely a marketable tool. And given what's happening in, with Amazon, given what's happening with tech companies, to have that type of credential, will make you extremely marketable in this new climate. So I think for me, just to your point about workforce development programs, we have so many that already exist. It's almost like, why create another one? But for me, when you create a targeted workforce development program that is attached to a company that has job opportunities currently, I feel like we can then be successful. So again, when you're partnering up with PICO, who are in constant need of skilled employees, I believe that's an opportunity for us not to just get them the skills, get them credentialed, but also get them that job opportunity, but also partnering with organizations like the West Philadelphia Skills Initiative. If they're teaching you how to get your CDL, that's a marketable piece that you can have to take out into the economy. So that is going to be, I'm going to have an eye towards achieving success in that way. Placement in that job, placement in that that institution or getting that credential that, again, makes you marketable.
Thanks, Rep. Cephas, and thank you so much to all of our attendees and to you for your great, great questions. As I stated, if we did not get a chance to get to your questions tonight, definitely follow up with our office. I know that some of our team members have also been responding in the chat and in the Q&A with our contact information and maybe some program information as well. Just as a notice, our office is closed until further notice. We are open on Wednesdays by appointment only. So if you do have a matter that needs in-person assistance, give us a call at 215-879-6625 or send us an email at repcephas@pahouse.net so we can make an appointment, get you in, and help you. Before we close out and hear closing remarks from Representative Cephas, we have one more poll question. We want to know, as we move forward, how can we best assist you? So you can pick as many as you need, but let us know some of the areas of focus that you will be turning to our office for, whether that will be access to COVID-19 relief, providing of personal protective equipment, access to state services, food distribution, employment opportunities, utility assistance, COVID-19 vaccine information, or if there's something else that you would be turning to our office and to Representative Cephas to assist you with as we move forward through this pandemic and away from it, hopefully sooner than later. So in 1 second, I'm going to pull up the next poll question. And you guys can go ahead and let us know, how will we be able to serve you moving forward? And Rep. Cephas, if you want to take this time while members of the community and attendees respond to this question, if you want to take this time to give us some closing remarks, then we'll leave you with that.
Of course. So, you know, first and foremost, I want to thank my staff for hanging in with me up until 8 p.m. to help coordinate tonight's discussion. So thank you all for providing me technical assistance because I probably couldn't do half of these things. So thank you for that. Thank you, Angie, for moderating tonight. And thank you, Ms. Gwen and Jeff, for helping to field the questions in the chat. But more importantly, I want to thank the community for, you know, just joining me tonight and, you know, just joining me on this ride as we navigate through this tough time, not just here in Philadelphia, but across the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania, across the country. I think so many have said we have a tough road ahead of us, especially here in Philadelphia. Not only are we, someone coined it as calling it a syndemic, where you have multiple pandemics happening all at one time. And when we think about the issue of COVID-19 and how it's exposing so many challenges in the infrastructure, in our healthcare system, in our education system, in our small businesses, I mean, things that we've known for some time, we recognize that, you know, we have to do better when we talk about rebuilding our country. But then we also have the other pandemic of gun violence that we've been, you know, dealing with and trying to tackle for some time. I think it's, you know, time that we find real solutions to these problems. I think it's going to be a collective effort always, but we have to make sure that we're creating buckets of opportunities for our families that are struggling with gun violence. So again, we have a tough road ahead of us, but I do think if we, you know, just stay in contact with each other, continuously having conversations, making recommendations on how our office can best, you know, support what you're doing in your communities, best support your family, providing the resources that you need in order to thrive in this district, that will make us, you know, do our jobs better. So thank you again for joining me tonight. We're going to do this again on Tuesday. I promise you my presentation won't be as long as it was tonight because you won't be able to look at anything. We'll just be over the phone. But I want to thank, you know, close to 100 people that joined us tonight for tonight's discussion. And, you know, if you want to come back and have, you know, a similar conversation, but also if your question wasn't answered, please feel free to join me at next week's town hall, which will be on Tuesday. We'll be posting additional information about that town hall on our social media outlets. Of course, you'll get a robocall and an email. So if you haven't signed up for that, please do. And I just say, you know, stay safe while you're in the city of Philadelphia. Make sure you please wear a mask, please do your social distancing. Mainly important, if you do get the vaccine, still please stay diligent on just protecting yourself, wearing that mask, using the PPE, and making sure that you're keeping your family safe.
Thanks so much, Representative Cephas. Again, thank you to everyone who attended. Please spread the word. On Tuesday, our teletown hall, our office will actually be calling you. So feel free to give our office a call or send us a quick email to make sure that you're on the call list, but you don't even have to use a Zoom code or pull out the computer or anything like that. We'll be calling you. Similar conversation, but definitely want to continue this conversation with the community. And if you're wondering what we'll be doing with this polling information, we'll be using it to help guide us moving forward as a team, help guide the representative. And so when we ask you guys, how can we serve you moving forward? We definitely want to take a close look at that and make sure that we're available to you in the ways that you need us most. So if you can see us on the screen, our contact information is shared there. You can also follow Rep. Cephas on Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram, and make sure you visit her website at www.pahouse.net. I'm sorry, www.pahouse.com/Cephas. So we hope to see you next week, and thank you so much for joining us. Thanks, Rep. Cephas and team.
Have a good night, everyone.
Good night.